Hello everyone, and welcome to episode 2 of Pigeon Genetics. If you haven't already watched episode 1, I'd definitely recommend it, because some of the terms I use in this video are explained in that one. And sorry about the volume at the beginning of the previous video. It gets louder a few minutes in, and there are subtitles available if you can't hear me. Today, we're going to learn about Punnett Squares, which are a great tool to calculate what kind of babies to expect from a pair of pigeons. But before we can learn about Punnett squares, we need to have a quick lesson on genetic notation. Genetic notation is a very useful shorthand we use to record the alleles that our birds carry and can pass on to their offspring. The system is quite simple, really. Each locus with at least one mutant allele is given a symbol comprised of one or more letters. The wild type at each locus is signified by a plus sign. The first letter of the mutant allele symbol gives us some valuable information. A capital letter means the allele is dominant to wild type, whereas a lowercase letter means the allele is recessive to wild type. Remember though, that some loci have more than one mutant allele. In this case, the same letter or letters are used, but we add a superscript or raised smaller letters after the symbol. The base colours make for a useful example here, because there are three of them. A wild type, blue, an allele that is recessive to wild type, brown, and an allele that is dominant to wild type, ash red. The base color series will have its own in-depth video in the future, where I'll explain their names, why blue is sometimes called black, and why the colors are important, but for now, we will just use them to understand notation. The mutant symbol for this locus is B, so you may hear it referred to as the B locus. Let's look at the symbols here. Brown, being recessive to the wild type, is simply given a lowercase b. Blue, being the wild type, can simply be noted with a plus sign, or a capital B followed by a plus sign, or superscript plus sign. Ash red is dominant to the wild type, so again it gets a capital B, followed by a superscript capital A. So to run through these again, we can tell that brown is recessive to wild type simply by looking at the symbol, a lowercase b. We know that blue is the wild type because we see the plus sign. We know that ash red is dominant to wild type because we see the capital letters in the allele symbol and the superscript letter. We've been able to pick up all this information about the alleles at the B locus simply by looking at their symbols and knowing nothing else about them. We're almost done learning about genetic symbols, but before we move on to Punnett squares, I'll quickly explain how we write down the genes carried by our pigeons. We use a forward slash to represent the chromosome. So let's imagine a homozygous recessive red pigeon. Recessive red is represented by the symbol E. So homozygous recessive red would be written as E slash slash E. This shows us that the recessive red allele is carried on both chromosomes. If the pigeon was only heterozygous recessive red, we would write E slash slash plus. If a bird carries one copy of a mutant allele and another copy of the wild type allele, we always write the mutant first. For example, we would write E slash slash plus, not plus slash slash E. We can build on this with other loci as well. Let's include the pigeon's eye colour. Pearl eyes are represented by the symbol TR. So a pigeon that was heterozygous for recessive red and homozygous for pearl eyes would be written as E slash slash plus space TR slash slash TR. You can keep building on this to express as many loci as you need. The only time it is different is when you are writing out a sex-linked gene on a hen. Hens only have one Z chromosome, so the missing chromosome in the pair is replaced by a bullet point. Let's use stipper or almond in an example. This gene is symbolized by the letters ST. A hemizygous stipper hen would be written out as ST slash slash bullet point. Every mutation and locus that has been studied by genetic professionals or amateur pigeon fanciers has been given a symbol, and they're all unique. If you're ever fortunate enough to discover a new mutation, you might also get the privilege of assigning it a symbol too. I've probably talked enough about genetic notation now, but if you have any questions, please feel free to ask them in the comments. Now that you have a basic understanding of how we use genetic notation, we can apply our knowledge to Punnett squares. Punnett squares are very useful for working out what to expect in future generations. I personally find myself using them all the time to calculate breeding expectations. They're so simple and easy to use. Today I'll teach you three different Punnett squares. The monohybrid cross, which is the simplest calculation used for autosomal genes. A sex-linked monohybrid cross. And the more complicated dihybrid cross, which we use for calculating genes at more than one locus at a time. Let's start with the monohybrid cross. Before we begin, you need to know that this calculation only works with alleles at the same locus. For example, we can do a calculation with bar and barless, but not bar and ash red, because these mutations are not alleles, they are completely unrelated to each other. Remember, you can go back and listen to episode 1 again if you've forgotten what words like allele and locus mean. You also need to know the genotype of your two pigeons before you can calculate their possible offspring. This includes any recessive alleles that the bird may be carrying but not expressing. Okay, so this is what an empty Punnett square looks like. We have a top line, a line at the side, and four boxes. The two open sections at the top represent the father's two chromosomes, and the two down the side represent the mother's. Let's fill it in, using CREST as an example. CREST is an autosomal recessive gene, and its symbol is CR. Let's start with two crested birds paired together. Both parents are homozygous CREST. So we place CR at the space for each chromosome on both parents. At the top, CR and CR, and the same down the side. Now we can fill in the four boxes that tell us what to expect in the next generation. Starting with the father, we fill in CR in all the boxes, because we know he is passing on his CREST genes. Then the same with the mother. Because both parents passed on CREST to all their offspring, all the young are homozygous for CREST. Okay, that was simple. You probably didn't need a Punnett square to know what would happen. What if one parent is crested, but the other doesn't carry the gene at all? We start with a fresh Punnett square, and we'll say the father is crested, whereas the mother isn't. So we write CR in the top spaces, and a plus sign in the side spaces. Remember, the plus sign represents wild type, which in this case means not crested. Now, we do the same as last time. Fill the squares with CR from the father, and pluses for wild type from the mother. Again, in this instance, all the young have the same genotype, but this time they are all heterozygous for CREST. This means they carry, but do not express, the recessive gene. Let's try one ever so slightly more complicated. Let's assume two birds who are both heterozygous for CREST are mated together. Again, in a fresh square, we fill in the parents, but this time they are both CR and wild type. The process is again the same. You might be used to it by now. The first column is filled with CR from the father, but the second gets the plus sign for the wild type allele he passes on to half his offspring. Then we fill in the mother. The top row gets her CR gene, and the bottom gets her wild type gene. In the second column, we'll flip the order from plus CR to CR plus, because like we said earlier, the mutant allele comes first in the list. This time, you'll notice there are not one, but three different genotypes in the graph. We have CRCR, which of course is homozygous CREST. We have two that are heterozygous CREST, and we have one that didn't receive a copy of the mutant CREST gene at all. Now remember, these are all averages. You aren't guaranteed this ratio when you're young. But on average, from this pair, you'd expect 25% of their babies to be crested, 50% to carry but not express the gene, and another 25% to not receive a copy altogether. Hopefully this explanation made sense. If not, please feel free to ask a question in the comments. Now, let's move on to a sex-linked mating. This time, we will use dilute as our example. Dilute is carried on the Z chromosome, and is symbolized by a small d. Remember, cocks have two Z chromosomes, whereas hens only have one. So hens can only carry one copy of the dilute gene. To start, we draw a Punnett square like normal. The top line is the same as before. Let's say the cock is homozygous wild type at the D locus, which you'll remember is symbolized by a plus sign. The hen side is a little different. She only has one Z chromosome. So we can replace the second one with the bullet point to signify the fact that the second chromosome doesn't exist. On her first, or more accurately only Z chromosome, we'll say she carries dilute, or D. Now we can fill in the squares like normal, and we also fill in the bullet points on the bottom row. Again, we have switched the plus and D in the top row, so that they're written in the correct order. The result here might look similar to the results from our previous standard monohybrid cross, but there is one key difference. The results are separated into the sexes of the babies. The top row of results are the options for cock babies, and the bottom row are the results for young hens. So we know from this example that all baby cocks carry dilute, but none of the baby hens do. Let's try it again, but we'll have the father carry one copy of the dilute mutation as well. This time, only half the young cocks are heterozygous carriers of dilute, and the other half are homozygous birds who express the dilute gene, whereas half the hens are hemizygous birds expressing dilute, and the other half are simply wild type. Calculating a sex-linked mating like this gives us a little piece of valuable information we don't have in a typical monohybrid cross. Now that we hopefully have a basic understanding of how Punnett squares work, we can move on to something a little more complicated. This is called a dihybrid cross. You might have been able to work out from the name that this time we're working with two different loci at the same time. This means our Punnett squares are also a lot bigger. I think the best way to explain a dihybrid cross is simply to jump into an example. So let's do it. Let's say we have a cockbird who is homozygous for recessive red and heterozygous for crest. And we have a hen who is heterozygous for recessive red and homozygous for crest. Now looking at this huge graph, you're probably going to want to put one allele in each box like we did previously. But this is not what we need to do. This is a very common mistake people make when they're trying to do a dihybrid cross, and is often the reason why people don't understand them. What we actually need to do is to remember that these alleles must be passed on in pairs that are inherited together. So they go into the squares as pairs. It is obvious when you think about it, but it trips up a lot of learners. So what do I mean by pairs? Well, let's input the father on the top line, and I'll show you. The two mutations we're working with are recessive red and crest. So in his first box, we'll put his recessive red gene and his crest gene. Did you see where I got them from? Okay. His next box, recessive red and wild type. Again, did you see where they came from? We follow the same pattern with the next two boxes. Do you see that we're taking an allele at the first locus, in this case recessive red, and matching it with the second, crest? We end up with all the possible combinations this pigeon can pass on to his offspring. Now we do the same for the hen. Again, I hope you can see where the genes in the boxes are coming from, and why they're there. So now we fill in the boxes for the next generation. We do this the same as we did in the monohybrid crosses, only this time we pass on a pair of genes from each parent instead of just one per box. So for example, in the top left, the baby receives a copy of recessive red and crest from both parents. Looking at our results, we can see that there are four possible genotype outcomes, each with a 4 in 16 or 25% chance of occurring. They are recessive red and crested, recessive red but only heterozygous crested, crested and heterozygous recessive red, and neither crested nor recessive red. It is possible to calculate Punnett squares with combinations of three or more genes, but the graphs get exponentially larger and become quite complicated. Personally, I think if you're trying to calculate the odds of more than two genes at a time, you're best to use a computer program to do it. Punnett squares are best for quick and simple calculations on the spot. This video ended up a lot longer than I had planned, but I hope the information has been understandable. If you have any questions, please feel free to leave them in the comments. I'll be sure to answer them. And remember, you can watch this video as many times as you need to. This is just episode 2 in what will end up being quite a long series on pigeon genetics. So please make sure you remember to subscribe. Thank you.